Chapter 1, Her Great Idea. Jack, Jack, I've had a truly wonderful inspiration, cried Pam as she came dashing down the stairs like a whirlwind. Unfortunately, Barbara, the little maid of all work, was at that moment toiling upwards with a soup tureen and a pile of plates on a tray. She was near the top, too, and very much out of breath. She had no strength to stand against the violent impact, but went down before it, being brought up in a heap at the turn of the stairs, while the tray, tureen, and plates went careening to the bottom, accompanied by a stream of soup. "Now you've done it," exclaimed Jack, with ominous growl in his voice, as, leaning on his stick, he came limping from the kitchen to survey the ruins. "Oh, haven't I just," cried Pam in a heartfelt contrition. Then she gasped, "Whatever will Mother say?" The afflicted Barbara, who still lay at the bend of the stairway where she had fallen, burst into noisy crying at this. She had been dismissed from her last place for ravages among the crockery, and if she had to leave the house of Mrs. Walsh for a similar cause, where would her character be? "Dry up," burst out Jack impatiently. "We have too much moisture here already, by the looks of it." As he spoke, he hopped aside to let a rivet of soup go past him. Such good soup it had been, too. The savory odor streamed up under his nose, and as he was desperately hungry, the waste was all more exasperating. Just at that moment, the green baize door at the top of the stairs opened smartly, and Greg called down, "Jack, Mother says don't let Barbara bring up the soup for another 10 minutes, because Colonel Seaforth has phoned to say he can't be here until then." "What luck!" exclaimed Pam. "Come along, Barbara. We can make a fresh lot of soup in 10 minutes, and we can serve it in a salad bowl and porridge plates. Dear me, nothing is ever so bad that it might not be worse. You can't make soup out of nothing, and there is not a teacupful of stock in the house," growled Jack. "Wait and see," laughed Pam, as she lightly sprang over the ruin at the bottom of the stairs, dodged down rivets of soup that meandered along the floor, and darted in at the kitchen door. "Come along, Barbara. England expects us. If you had done your duty and looked where you were going, the soup would not have been spilled," growled Jack, but Pam was too busy to heed him. Seizing the empty soup saucepan, she half-filled it with hot water from the boiler and set it over the fire. Then she darted to the table, where she stood busy stirring, mixing, and pounding and calling all the time for a succession of things which Barbara was quick to supply. "There, that will do, I think," she exclaimed in great satisfaction. "Corn flour, tomato powder, salt, pepper, a good lot of whatever Worcester sauce, burnt sugar, and a dash of shrimp sauce, just by the way of piquancy. Very nice to look at and interesting to taste. Not very nourishing, perhaps, but that will not matter for once." The hot water was poured on the concoction, the stuff was turned to the saucepan and brought to a boil. Then, 10 minutes being up, Pam carried the emergency soup to the dining room herself, while Barbara collected the fragments of broken earthenware and stabbed up the river of soup with a grubby mop. "Well, you take the cake, and no mistake about it," and rising to the occasion, admired Jack with a grudging admiration as he limped about the kitchen, getting ready for the fish course, and seeing that other things were keeping in a state of readiness. Pam's merry laugh rang out. "It is a mercy I can do so much, for it is my fate to always be creating situations that call for dispatch and skill in the managing." Jack looked at her in silent wonder. Somehow he always was wondering at Pam. It was barely more than half an hour by the clock since she had been drowned in tears because of a curt letter from Lady Dobley, who had written to say that as she could not have Miss Walsh when she needed her so much, she had secured another governess. Pam's salary had not been much, but in poverty like theirs, every little counts. There was a doctor's bill for Muriel's illness, with all other bills which had sprung from the same source, while winter was coming on. But it was of no use to grouse over things. It did not make them the least better. So he left off speculating about Pam and ordered Barbara to round in fine style for the next 20 minutes. And the courses of dinner went up one by one until all over. When coffee had been taken to the drawing room, Greg and Sid cleared the dining table and then came down to their supper in the breakfast room, which opened out of the kitchen. Pam, who had rushed upstairs to see if Muriel was comfortable asleep, came hurrying back to help in washing up the silver and glasses. "Then what is your great idea?" asked Jack, who was seated on a high stool at the table and was rapidly polishing the spoons and forks which Pam had washed. She glanced round and saw that the door of the scullery, where Barbara was washing plates and dishes, was a little way open, and darting across the room, closed it softly. "Jack," she cried, with positive rapture in her tone, as she plucked her hands into the soapy water again, "Jack, I am going to ask Mother to let me go to Grandfather." "You can't go alone. You are only a girl," he exclaimed, dropping a handful of spoons with a clatter, because he was so amazed at the daring and audacity of Pam's great idea. She laughed softly. It always amused her to hear Jack talk in this fashion. She was 4 years older than he was, and although she lacked his steadiness and balance, she knew that she was vastly ahead of him when it came to dealing with an emergency. "You are a dear, Jack, but you have your limitations. You are quite early Victorian in your ideas of what girls should or should not do, but you have got to widen your outlook a bit more before Mother comes down from the drawing room, because you must back me up in this. We can always influence Mother when we stand solid, and my great idea is for the general good." For instance, Jack had received the fallen spoons and was polishing vigorously. Pam had a good many ideas of one sort or another, but he had a cautious streak and was not going to back her up in any wild scheme just because she wanted him to do so. "Grandfather told Mother to send one of us out to him, and he promised to pay a salary. He said one of the children, but he did not mention whether it was a boy or a girl that he would prefer." Pam put out her facts with a calm decision, and Jack nodded approvingly. "Very well, you can't go. It will be another month before you can walk without a stick, and when you can, there is your work at Gay's and Granger's waiting for you. Until you go back, they are paying you." "A mere pittance, half a crown a week, accident insurance," he groaned. "If only I had been over 16, I could have had the proper state insurance. It is a rotten shame, and the grossest injustice." "Be quiet and let me talk," Pam lifted an impatient hand to stay the tide of his eloquence, sprinkling him with soapy water in the process. "You have this pittance and work waiting for you, but I have nothing. You also are twice the help to Mother that I am. Don't interrupt. Compliments are not necessary at this juncture. We are out of facts without trimming, and don't forget it. Suppose that you had gone out to Grandfather's this month. Mother says the winters in New Brunswick are dreadfully cold. Being a boy, you would naturally have had to work outdoors, and if there's no woman in the house, you would have little comfort when you came in. Now, if I go, the dear little old man can hardly send me out into the forest chopping trees down when the temperature is miles below zero, but I can make him so comfortable in the house that by way of the spring he will be want the lot of us." "Query as to that," Jack shook his head and reached for the plate basket to put away his spoon. "Oh, but he will. I shall lay myself out to win his heart. Then when he has got so fond of me that he simply can't bear me out of his sight, I shall turn homesick. I shall refuse my food and tell him that I am pining for my family, that I can bear the cruel separation no longer. He will soften towards Mother then and write her an imperative letter to sell up and come out to him without a moment's unnecessary delay. Oh, I can imagine it now. Oh, I can manage him. I have no doubt of it at all." "I don't think that I have either, if you go straight at it," admitted Jack, who spoke from experience, knowing himself to be weak as water in the hands of Pam when she had really made up her mind to influence him. "The question in my mind is whether Mother and he will hit it off comfortably when they live together. She is a mistress here and does as she likes, but it would not be happy for her if the old man took to ordering her around as I do Barbara." "Indeed, no, but I can tell you he can be managed. He must be managed for his own good," she said earnestly. "If he is very happy and comfortable, he will not want to be tiresome. Think of how good it will be for Muriel to have a country life for the next few years. Think, too, what it will do for the boys. Greg is growing much too fast. He ought to have quiet evenings and to be in bed by 8 o'clock, instead of which he and Sid are working hard until after 9 on most evenings, waiting at tables and clearing away, qualifying for posts as footmen and butlers, but missing all the free and easy life of boyhood that they ought to have." Jack drew a long breath which ended in a whistle. "My word, if you talk to the old man like that, he will be sending for us by the next boat. I will back you up for all I am worth. See if I don't. 3 cheers for Pam, the pioneer, the intrepid, and the brave. of all the great ideas you have ever had, this is the greatest." Pam flushed with pleasure. Jack had the balance and steadiness which she lacked. He was apt to sit in judgment on her, and that sort of thing is rather unbearable as a rule. Her mother was always holding Jack before her eyes as a model to be studied and copied, which of course was more unbearable still, so that the present moment was sweet indeed, compensating for many a bad quarter of an hour which had come before. "I must hurry to Muriel now," she said 10 minutes later, when they had discussed the scheme and all its bearings. "Be sure you stick by me, Jack, when it comes to arguments, for you know I do not shine there." "Oh, I will stick by you, never fear," he answered in a cheery tone. "I would do a good deal to see a way out of this boarding house business, this sewing and grilling down here every night, to give those people upstairs a chance to overfeed themselves, gets on my nerves. The folks who are so keen on big dinners at 8 o'clock at night ought to have to cook for themselves. Then they would soon be cured of the habit." "I dare say they would, but think what a crowd of people would suffer from loss of income," Pam laughed as she gave him a bear-like hug by way of showing her gratitude. "Think, too, what a slump there would be in the medical business, for Dr. Scott said yesterday that it was the people who ate too much who provided the doctors with a living." But Jack only grunted by way of answer, and then, taking his stick, limped out of the scullery to see if Barbara had fastened up for the night. Chapter 2. Business Enterprise. Galena Gittens had her hair sewed up tightly in curling pins. Reggie Furness was late in coming to do chores that morning, so he had crept in by way of the milk room door with as little obstination as possible. He had found by experience that it was not wise to attract attention to himself when he was behind time. Directly he noticed the curling pins, his courage revived. The fair Galena was never hard to live with when there was a festivity to fore. She was dashing around in such a way that she even failed to notice his silent entrance. He picked up the milk buckets and scurried away to the barn, well pleased at his escape, but actively curious as to the sort of frolic to which Galena was found that day. "There was no one dead, nor it can't be a funeral," he muttered, as he tied the white cow's leg to a post to prevent her kicking while he milked. "It isn't a wedding either, or else I should have been bound to hear about it. Her aunt has gone to Friedrichsen, so she can't be going there." He was so absorbed in his meditations that he did not notice that the rope had come unfastened until the cow, by an adroit movement, knocked him sprawling. He was used to her pranks by this time, and he contrived to keep the bucket from being kicked over, so his own upset did not count. And as he always pretended to himself that the white cow was a playful creature, instead of, as was actually the case, a bad-tempered animal, his feelings were not roughed by this being rolled over and having his head thumped against a post. When he carried the milk buckets into the little chamber that was scooped out from the side of the hill, he heard signs of an unusual bustle in the kitchen, and poking his head cautiously round the post of the door, he was amazed to see a big baking in progress. "Is that you, Reggie Furness?" called the voice of Galena, who was darting here and there, apparently trying to do three things at once. "Step lively, will you? And will you help me here? I want eggs whisked and currants washed, sugar rolled, and a dozen things done all nearly at once. You can't have a sitting down breakfast this morning, but none of us have had that. You have to be content to feed as you run about." "I don't care how I have my breakfast, as long as I do have one," said Reggie, who had got a hold of the whisker and was turning it at great rate, while the eggs churned into yellow foam under its active exertion. Galena laughed at the broadness of the hint, but she had not had six brothers without knowing that boys were the hungriest of creatures under the sun, so she brought him a great wedge of pumpkin pie just to keep him from starving, and promised him some hot cookies as soon as they were out of the oven. The pie was fragrant with spice and black with currant. Reggie was in clover for once in his life. Breakfast, which was part of his wage, consisted in usual way of buckwheat or oatmeal porridge drowned out with skim milk. There was no porridge pot visible this morning, so plainly there was something very unusual on hand. "Please, are you going to be married today?" he asked, his eyes fairly bulging with curiosity. The ham boiler was on the stove, and it was beginning to bubble while delicious odors filled the kitchen and made their way through the open door, this question was only a wild hazard. He had never heard that Miss Galena had any new views with regards to matrimony, but he guessed that in any case it would please her to be asked, and so he would be the more likely to find out what he wanted to know so badly. He was through with the whisking by now, and Miss Galena had set him rolling sugar. He would not have taken any, of course, being irreproachably honest so far as he understood what honesty meant, but he saw no harm in continually licking his fingers as he drew the sugar in lumps for the rolling pin. It was good. He would have enjoyed rolling sugar all day long. Galena burst into a great laugh of derision, but she was not ill-pleased at the suggestion. "Dear me, no. I'm not going to be married yet, though you never can tell what may happen." She lifted her head and tried to look springly, but she was so worn with hard work and much dyspepsia that the attempt was rather a failure. Reggie looked disappointed. If the festivities were not a wedding or a funeral, he did not see what it could be. No church functions were in progress this month, for the parson's was away on holiday, and it would not have been considered in good taste to have a church frolic in his absence. Galena's eyes sparkled. She was aching for someone to talk things over with. The men were always in a hurry when they came in from the field, and there was not another woman within half a mile of the place. She hesitated and was lost. "We are going to have a great frolic tonight. It is only decided late last night. That is why I am so driven with cooking this morning. We are going to have a big surprise party at old Rack Prevail's. You know where he lives? Over on the ridge at Ripple? They say he is a most fearful, disagreeable old man. He lives quite alone and has done so for more years than you have been alive. I've heard he made a vow that no woman should ever enter his house on the account of his only daughter having run away from him to get married. Don't you expect it will make him sit up when all lot of us come walking in? Suppose he won't let you inside the door?" Reggie started at her with bulging eyes. He was thinking of what had happened at his own poor home 2 winters before, when he and Mose had gone to bed and had been hounded out by a surprise party that threatened to pull the shingles off the roof if they were not admitted. Mose had been furious at the invasion, for the cupboard was empty, the stark poverty of the home had all been laid bare to the laughing, careless crowd who had taken the place by storm. "Suppose he can't keep us out," she mocked. "I just love surprise parties when there is a spice of mischief in them. When we go to persons and take more food than we could eat in a month and leave it all behind for him and Mrs. White, it is almost as tame as going to church on Sunday or having a missionary meeting and giving money to convert the heathen. But when we go to surprise someone who does not want to see us, why, that is where the fun begins." Reggie nodded in a token of understanding, but he was spared the necessity of a reply by the entrance of Nathan Grittens, the eldest brother to Galena, who ran the farm and the sawmill, all four brothers in between having left New Brunswick for far west when they came to man's estate. All the way to school that morning, Reggie fumed over the injustice of old Rack Prevail. In forcing a surprise party, mostly of women, upon him when he had said that no woman should enter his house. Reggie had not had much to do with women since his mother died. He had been only a shaver of 5 years old then, and he had been dragged up ever since by his stepbrother, Mose Paget, who owned a long strip of rather unfertile land running parallel with the creek, but separated from the water by Sam Buckle's quarter section of water frontage. All through morning school, Reggie debated the matter with so much absorption that he had no attention to give to mischief, and in consequence earned the good conduct mark to his great amazement. Directly school was out, and he set off to climb the ridge, not going by the ordinary trail that led past Ripple, but by taking a beeline through the woods and up over the gap where the forest fire had been 2 years before. He had serious business on hand, while his consciousness troubled him a little, because he was going to betray the confidence of Galena. He had made up his mind to warn Rack of what was impending, so that the old man should have a chance of doing as he liked about being at home when the visitors came. The day was very hot, although, and it was October. The maple leaves on the ridge were aflame with autumn splendor, and the scarlet of the oaks at Cumberland's Crossing was a sight to see, but Reggie had scant attention for the beauty of nature, for he was in a hurry. Make the best speed he could, it would be almost impossible for him to get back to the schoolhouse before afternoon school began, and if he had no satisfactory excuse for being late, he would have the cane. To be late at morning school was a forgivable offense, because of the long distance the scholars had to come and the heaviness of the morning chores at most of the homes. But there was no excuse for being late in afternoon, because no one went home then, and it did not take long to eat the noon piece each scholar had brought in his or her school bag. From the top of the ridge to Ripple was easy going. Downhill all the way, Reggie crashed through the undergrowth at great rate. He had no watch, but could only guess at the time. Every minute gained would make one stroke of the cane the less, for the rule was one stroke for every minute late, so it was necessary to use dispatch. When he emerged at the clearing in front of the house, he saw the old man doing something to a gun in front of the old chip house door. Quickening his pace, Reggie was making straight toward him, but before he could clamber through the hole in the garden fence, a quavering shout reached him. "Now then, stay where you are, boy. If you come a step nearer, I will set the dog at you." Rat's aspect was so threatening that Reggie decided to be the best part of valor to stay where he was, especially as a powerful dog which had been lying on the ground rose at this moment and growled in menacing fashion. "I have come to tell you something that you will be glad to know," called Reggie. "Tell it then and be off. I don't want a lot of loafers on this premises," growled the old man, and enraged though he was, Reggie's face twitched in a grin of amusement. One small perishing boy had run all the way from the schoolhouse could hardly be described as a lot of loafers. "Gritton's folk and a lot of other women are going to have a surprise party here tonight. They are going to bring supper and dance to an accordion afterwards," called out Reggie in clear tones which carried amazingly in the hot, still air. If he had been able to whisper the information, it would not have seemed so bad. But to be obliged to shout out what an honor he ought to have kept silent about made him so angry that he hated the old man he had come so far to serve. Rat gave a sorrowful, crackling laugh, and the dog growled in sympathy. "If the surprise party comes here, it is likely they may find themselves a bit surprised," the old man called back, and then he went on clearing his gun as if no one were there. "Ain't you going to give me nothing for coming all this way to tell you?" demanded Reggie, in a shrill tone of indignation. It was past believing that this disagreeable old man should actually refuse to reward him for all his trouble. "I'll give you the stick if you don't clear out of this sharp," the old man retorted with a snarl, and he looked as if he meant it. Reggie was insistent and inclined to clamor for what he deemed his rights, so he burst into angry, noisy abuse after the manner of his kind. "Think I'm going to put up with that sort of treatment, do you? A regular old skinflint you are, and no mistake. I hope the surprise party will come, scores of them, and I hope they will dance and dance till your carpets are in rags and they have worn holes in your floors." "Here, dog, after him," exclaimed the old man, swinging his hand with an air of exasperation in Reggie's direction. But Reggie was not going to stay on the chance of a mauling. The dog was a big animal, and he was only rather a small boy. So he fled away with the speed of a hunted fox, and the dog, having pursued him to the end of the cleared ground, gave up the chase, returning toward the house in a languid trot, as if the exertion was too much on such a hot day. There was no slacking of Reggie's speed until he was well on his way. Then, as the ascent of the ridge grew steeper, he dropped into a walk. There was a black hate in his heart for the old man who had treated him so badly, and he was meditating all manner of wild and possible schemes for getting better of him as he toiled over the ridge. Then he broke into a trot again where the ground sloped to the schoolhouse. It would be late, he was sure of it, and he would have the cane. He had broken a confidence reposed in him, and he had gained nothing by it. No wonder he was furious. As he turned to enter the school door, he shook his fist in an impotent rage at the wooden ridge he had just crossed.